This podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
Good afternoon. I'm going to continue with the discussion that we I will take it from the point where we got the last time. I will use this benefit that Rami gave some information, a lot of information about black holes, so therefore you are prepared. But let me discuss some aspects that I will need later. So now, one of the things, in order to understand what are black holes, quantum mechanically, so at the end of the day, we want to move towards understanding the quantum mechanical nature of black holes and the substructure, if they have one, okay? And now, okay, first, one of the questions we want to answer, how small black holes could be, okay? Now, sometimes you find the statements that elementary particles, because they are point-like, they are black holes, okay? Now, the argument of this statement, behind this statement, is roughly the following argument, right? You say, okay, let's take an elementary particle with some mass, a massive elementary particle, let's say of the something like electron mass, okay, of the order of MeV, 0.5 MeV, half MeV. Because mass is finite, this particle automatically has a corresponding Schwarzschild gravitational radius, okay? So this gravitational radius of the electron is, of course, is tiny. So gravitational radius would be what? Would be the electron mass times g newton, right? This is approximately in h particle 1 units, because since this is independent of h bar, you can evaluate this, right? This would be like a mass of the electron divided by m Planck square, or which is the same mass of the electron m Planck times l Planck. And this would be something like 10 to the minus, so this is 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, this is 10 to the 19 GV, so MeV, so we get something like 10 to the minus 55 centimeters, okay? Now, of course, this is tiny, but it's still finite. Then you say, okay, so the electron has a mass, has an associated Schwarzschild radius, and it's point-like because it's elementary, so it must be a black hole, because it is sitting somewhere inside of a Schwarzschild radius, okay? Now, this argument is a pure nonsense, okay? It's completely wrong, and this is very important to understand why it is wrong, okay? Now, you see, there are these type of simple statements that are extremely deep and important for understanding black hole physics. Now, the reason why this argument is wrong, because it assumes that being elementary means zero size. And that's not true, because being elementary only means that there is no substructure. When we say that electron is elementary, we simply mean that it doesn't have a substructure. There are no entities, quantum field theoretic entities, which describe, can be appropriately thought of as the constituents of the electron. That's why we say that electron is elementary. But being elementary doesn't mean that it has no size. In fact, quantum mechanics is telling us that there is automatically the size associated with every form of a corresponding length scale associated with every form of energy, in particular a massive particle, right? So electron has this length scale, which is called Compton wavelength, which is simply inverse of the mass in h bar, with the times h bar, okay? Now, this Compton wavelength for electron, in fact, if you evaluate this, this is approximately something like 44 orders of magnitude bigger than its corresponding Schwarzschild radius, okay? So this for the electron, particularly for the electron. Now, what's the meaning, what's the physical meaning of Compton wavelength? You know this very well. Compton wavelength is a characteristic scale at which the energy of quantum fluctuations becomes as important as the energy of the electron itself, okay? So in other words, if you try to localize electron at distances much shorter than its corresponding Compton wavelength, you have to invest into the electron energy which is higher than the electron mass itself, and in fact could be much higher than what is enough for creating extra electron extra 10 electrons or whatever, okay? So this is the radius on which you are disturbing the system so much that it stops to be a system that you wanted to measure, okay? So for example, let's do this exercise for the gravitational radius. It's very simple. Suppose I want to do the following thing. I want to really build a microscope and I try to measure, which will tell me that electron is definitely localized somewhere within its Schwarzschild radius, okay? Now, if I need to do that, this means that somehow I have to create a situation, or you can create a microscope, or in fact you can manufacture, if you are powerful enough with a lot of money, a lot of accelerators, you can manufacture the quantum state of an electron with wave function being localized, sharply localized in some distance within its Schwarzschild radius, okay? Now, so in either case, if you want to measure electron and say that, okay, electron is definitely within its Schwarzschild radius, you have to transfer the momentum to the electron of the order of h bar divided by the Schwarzschild radius, okay? Now, this means that you are disturbing electron so much that now the mass of the electron, the energy of the electron localized within that region, will be, actually, if you evaluate this number, you get something like the mass of Halley's comet. Okay, so electron will become heavier than the comet. Of course, this is no longer an electron, whatever it is. Okay, so therefore, now what are we learning from here is that the Schwarzschild radius of an electron is a fictitious scale. Okay, it's formal, you can define it. But there is no physics associated to it, okay? Associated to that length scale, okay? So that's why electron is not a black hole, because the Schwarzschild radius, because the Compton wavelength of an electron is much larger than the gravitational radius of the electron, okay? Now let's ask the following question. Okay? Now let me take an electron and do the following thought experiment: make it heavier and heavier, okay? What happens if I make electron heavier? What happens is that you understand what happens, because the Compton wavelength is inverse of mass, and the gravitational radius is linear in mass. So making electron heavier, you increase gravitational radius and you decrease the Compton wavelength, and at some point they are going to meet. Okay. Now where is the meeting point? To see where is the meeting point is basically, well, you can use any of these expressions. For example, I can multiply and divide by this by g Newton, okay? And then I can rewrite this as so I will have g Newton here and me g Newton here, right? This is the gravitational radius, right? And this is the Planck length square, right? So then this is Planck length, and Planck length divided by the gravitational radius. Okay? Now, these two, like any of the two length scales can only be equal when all of them are equal, okay? So basically the meeting point is when the Planck length is equal to the gravitational radius, and it's equal to the Compton wavelength, okay? This is the picture. So now, so we can draw this picture pictorially like this. So this is the length scale. Let's say here we have Planck length here somewhere, and this is the mass. And then, okay, so the gravitational radius increases like linear. The Compton wavelength goes down. I don't know if this was the, okay, let's make it. And they meet. Let me move Planck scale here. They meet at the Planck length. Okay? So this is the picture. So in other words, what happens is what this diagram is telling you is that this is the world of the elementary particles, okay? And then this is the world of black holes, and they meet at the Planck length, okay? So at the Planck length, elementary particle is something in between, okay? So it's not yet a fully fledged black hole. Why? Because the quantum effects are extremely important in all possible ways, okay? But on the other hand, it's a very strongly gravitating object. So in particular, the particle with the Planck-Compton wavelength, the corresponding alpha gravity is 1, okay, for this particle, for a single particle even. And so it's literally in between, okay? There is there are entities which we, sometimes people call them quantum micro black holes, or at least I call it that way, or the boundary between black holes and elementary particles, okay? So now, so this is inevitable, because in order to understand black holes quantum mechanically, you must have a boundary beyond which the black hole becomes an elementary particle, okay, or something else. Now, for example, what happens in classical physics? In classical physics, this size goes to zero, okay? Why? Because the Planck length goes to zero. So that's why in classical physics, first of all, in classical physics, elementary particles are simply massless, okay? They are infinitely many, and they are massless. So the Compton wavelength is always infinite, okay? And because h bar is sorry, Compton wavelength is, well, depends how you normalize, okay? Depends on the how you introduce the mass. But in any case, the when you go into classical physics, the h bar goes to zero, and so the notion of the elementary particle simply gets abolished. Okay, it can become infinitely. The energy can go to zero, and you get infinite number of them, and so on. Okay. So in classical physics, the elementary particles and black holes, they never meet. Okay, because black holes can be arbitrarily small and finite mass. So here's the thing, right? If we are classical, then h bar is zero. Then I can have finite mass black holes. And they can be arbitrarily light, okay? Why? Because Planck scale is zero, and Planck mass is also zero. So therefore, I can make a black hole that is arbitrarily a classical black hole, which is arbitrarily light and arbitrarily small. Now, in a semi-classical picture, H bar is non-zero. But remember, we defined it semi-classical picture. In semi-classical picture, black holes are infinitely heavy. So the mass is infinite. Newton's constant is zero. So therefore, Planck length is again zero. And correspondingly, again, they don't meet. Because any finite, of course, now you can have elementary particles. They can have finite mass. But black holes are infinitely heavy. Okay. So in other words, in classical picture and in semi-classical picture, elementary particles and black holes, they never meet. They are two different worlds, okay? They only meet in quantum theory, in which both, in which everything is finite. Newton's constant is finite, black hole mass is finite, Planck constant is finite, and Planck length is also finite. Then there is inevitably there is a meeting point. And this is very nice, because this is one key how to understand that you can go, because you see, if the two entities never meet, then it's extremely hard to conclude that black holes should have some quantum substructure, right? Because they never meet. You can always say that black holes belong to the, they are out of this world, okay? I can never produce them because they are either infinitely heavy or I don't have any elementary particles, so they never meet. And so they are totally mysterious. But the fact that they meet tells you that demystifies the problem, because it tells you that black holes are normal guys. You should be able to produce them by putting together elementary particles. Moreover, you should be able to produce them in particle collisions, okay? And they, after all, they are not that mysterious. Of course, they are beautiful, but not that mysterious, okay? And this is the point. This is very important, okay? Okay, so now let's go to the next step, okay? We mentioned this briefly also. Rami described this. Let me just remind you in very simple terms, okay? Now, in semi-classical case, right? In semi-classical case, when we have, okay, what I wrote there, okay, semi-classical. Okay, we have infinitely massive black hole. Newton's constant goes to zero. The gravitational radius is fixed. And H bar is non-zero, okay? So in this limit, as you know from the previous lectures, Hawking did computation, which shows that in this limit you have black holes, you have a radiation coming out of a black hole, okay? And the spectrum of radiation is exactly thermal. So the picture is that you are getting a spectrum of radiation, which it has characteristic temperature, so-called Hawking temperature, which is something like h bar over r. Let me, I'm also setting Boltzmann equal to 1, and et cetera. This is the characteristic temperature, and correspondingly, the black hole radiates. Now, because black hole radiates, you have a Stefan Boltzmann law of radiation, okay, as if it radiates like an ideally black body. So there is a time evolution of energy, released energy, right? So we have something like okay, something like that. Now, okay, we have this Stefan Boltzmann law of energy release, okay, by a black hole. Now, this may create a false impression that black hole is losing its mass. But actually, it's not losing its mass because mass is infinite. Okay? So therefore, despite the fact that it's like an infinite capacitor in that limit, okay? Despite the fact that it radiates, okay, it will never decay, finally, okay? It's eternal. Now, from here, you can evaluate the lifetime of a black hole, okay? To evaluate the lifetime of a black hole, you can, it's very easy because you have to rewrite this. I don't know if Ramit already did this, but you can rewrite this in terms of the mass and the Newton's constant, okay? And then you can just integrate this equation because you have, you can separate variables, right? Then you will have that m squared dm. This goes like dt, okay? And so the lifetime of a black hole goes as mass q, okay? There are several convenient ways in which we can rewrite this. Okay, for example, one of the convenient way is to express this through the entropy, okay, of a black hole. And so this is then you can get the following structure. Okay, I can rewrite this, manipulating with h's and L Planck square times r, rg. Now, this is an entropy, so this means that this black hole lifetime is proportional to the entropy in the size units, okay? Now, this immediately is telling you that whenever you are in semi-classical limit, okay, L Planck is zero, okay, r is fixed, L Planck is zero, so the lifetime of a black hole is infinity, okay? Or, which is the same, as from here you can see it immediately, that the, again, T black hole is proportional to the mass cubed, right? This is another way to see it. So when mass goes to infinity, of course the lifetime goes to infinity, despite the fact that this, the size is finite. So in this regime, so therefore, let's summarize what we understand in these regimes. We understand that in these regimes, both classical and semi-classical, there is no mystery, okay? Semi-classically, you have an object which has arbitrary mass, but it's eternal. It's not radiating. Semi-classically, you have an object which is radiating, but again, it's eternal because it's infinitely heavy. Okay? In both of these limits, everything is fine. You can store an infinite amount of information in this type of a black hole. You will never get it back, but there is no problem because the black hole is also eternal. Okay? Just store it eternally in the black hole. Now, the seeming puzzle, or the question, let me even not call it puzzle, but sometimes it's called, as you know, information paradox, it's coming once you try to make black hole mass finite. In other words, you want to go into a fully quantum theory, okay? Now, if I make black hole mass finite, then the whole question is what the observer sees, okay? How the spectrum of radiation of a finite mass black hole, but finite mass means that it's now it's fully quantum, is modified relative to the ideal thermal spectrum, okay? This is the key question. Now, without knowing answer to this question, we can improvise infinitely, okay? Somebody will say corrections are negligible, somebody else will say no corrections are important, and so on, right? But if we don't know how big are the corrections, we cannot conclude anything about about anything about any inconsistency or anything about any paradox or anything like that. Okay? So this is extremely important to understand what is the correction to the spectrum for a real black hole. Okay? Now the question is, how can we answer this question? What is the correction to the spectrum of a real black hole? Because this correction cannot be semi-classical. Why? Because in semi-classical theory, we don't have a correction. It has to be an intrinsically quantum correction. Now, therefore, to answer the question, okay, what is the underlying physics of this correction, or even how strong it is, we need a microscopic theory of a black hole. Okay? So you need to make some in physics, we normally, what do? We make some assumptions, right? We say, okay, I have a postulate that this is how it should be. Then we go ahead and we try to check self-consistency of this postulate, okay? First, we try to check whether this postulate reproduces everything we know, okay, correctly, in the limits that we know. Then we press on and see what it predicts. Sometimes it may predict a nonsense. Then we say, okay, we close this chapter because this postulate is inconsistent. Okay, this is how it works. So we need some initial input, a theory, which will tell us what is the constituency or what is the substructure of a black hole, okay? Now, this theory could be, you may like it, somebody may like it, somebody not like it. This postulate may look complicated, may look simple. It may be wrong even, or right. But that's a secondary point because you need something to start with. Otherwise, you cannot answer the question, okay? You need a framework. Okay, so therefore, what I will try to do, I will try to describe a framework. But what I will try to do, I will try to do it in extremely general terms, okay? So that there is a huge room for improvisation if you want to fine-tune the details, okay? Just to separate what is secondary, what can be technicalities or some fine-tuning of the framework, and what are the major postulates that you cannot avoid, okay? This is the question. So, therefore, I will ask the following question. The question is very simple. Do black holes have substructure? Or are they elementary? Okay? Now, as I just explained in the language of elementary particles, right, elementarity doesn't mean that the object cannot have a size. You can have arbitrarily big size of an object, but object could still continue to be elementary, okay? So the question is whether black holes have any substructure, whether they have some composite nature, but composite nature in a well-defined sense. Okay. Now, before trying to answer this question, we have to understand what we mean under compositeness. When I tell you that, okay, I'm asking whether black hole is composite, what do I mean? I mean, what I'm looking for. Okay. Why? Why this is an important question? Because you can tell me, for example, why do I care if black hole is composite or not? For me, it's enough that black hole, there is some quantum state in some Hilbert space, okay, of quantum gravity, yeah.
You mean like a geometric substructure or a microstate?
Yeah, the question will show us the way, okay? Yeah. So far, we are asking, that's why I'm saying, let's be extremely general and open-minded, okay? So not to miss any opportunity at any turn, okay? So far, as you see, what I'm trying to do now, I'm even trying to understand what is the question that I'm asking, okay? Right? So just to make clear. Why? Because you can always tell me, why do I need substructure? Give me some state vector, and that's a vector in the Hilbert space, okay? What do you mean when you say elementary? Simply, this, whatever you call elementary or composite, is just some state in my Hilbert space. Okay, so now you can ask exactly the same question about any other entity. For example, this table, okay? It's the same thing, right? We can say, of course, this table for me, I can say that this table is described by a quantum state in the Hilbert space, okay? Very, very, very nice quantum state, a table, okay? And why do I care if it's elementary or composite? But nevertheless, we care, right? When we say table, nobody thinks in the right mind that table is elementary, right? Despite the fact that it's a fully legitimate quantum state, okay? So, now, this means that there is something about these entities that are composite which makes us think that it's better to think about them as composites than to think about them as elementary. It's a question of convenience, okay? Now, question of convenience in physics is very important because question of convenience allows you to solve very hard problems, right? Precisely by going into convenient language and convenient description, this is the half of the job, right? You have to find a appropriate description for a given problem. Now, so when we say that the table is elementary, there is not elementary, it's composite. The reason is that it satisfies a couple of conditions, okay? It has a couple of properties. For example, what is the property number one? Property number one is that there is a notion of constituents, okay? So I can say the table consists of molecules, all right? So they are constituents. Okay, fine. Now, what does it mean to have constituents? Constituents means that there is some, in case of table, there is a counterpart, okay, which I can describe as an asymptotic state, for example, asymptotic state of an S matrix. This is a molecule or atom or whatever you want to call it, right? Now, this molecule I can describe as an asymptotic state, okay? And the table, or whatever my macroscopic object, is made out of this. And it's legitimate to say that this object is composite because, not because, if one situation when it's legitimate is that these constituents are only mildly off-shell as compared to their counterparts, asymptotic counterparts, okay? So in other words, this is true for this is true about molecules. In other words, to knock out a molecule out of the table, okay, the momentum transfer that I need in a process is much milder than the mass of a molecule, okay? So in other words, that's why molecules, they continue to have some identity even within a table, okay? That's why you say, okay, molecules consist, I can think in terms of this guy as a composite, okay? This is one thing, one property that the ordinary bodies satisfy. What is the other property? The other property is that you can have, essentially this is what I just said, you can have processes with momentum transfer, okay, which is smaller, so that which is smaller than the some characteristic energy by which you characterize your constituent, okay, asymptotic state. Now, these three conditions, if they are satisfied, okay, then it's convenient to call an object being composite, okay? Now, however, at this point, you should stop me and tell me, no, but this is too restrictive, okay, to impose these conditions, okay, because we have entities in quantum field theory which we consider composite but do not satisfy these properties, okay? For example, let's take baryon in QCD. Baryon in QCD doesn't satisfy these properties because quarks are not asymptotic states, okay? So, for example, okay, quarks do not exist, okay? So baryon is a bound state of quarks. I don't know, sometimes people visualize this in this way, okay? And quark bound state, if I have QCD, and SU and QCD, okay? The quarks are not asymptotic states. Therefore, all these things, these comparisons I cannot make. Despite the fact, nevertheless, it's useful to think about baryon as a composite. And because of very special property of asymptotic freedom, okay? Because of this very special property that there is a region of length scales on which description in terms of quarks is the right description. That's why we say that baryon is composite, okay? Not because of these properties. Okay, so now what I will try to do first, I'll try to see if, so in other words, I don't know, you can call this as a requirement, weak requirement of compositeness or strong requirement, whatever you want. So, yeah. Because the Compton wavelength is much smaller than the geometric size. Yeah, but sure, no, that's perfectly fine. But then you should define geometric size. What do you mean? Yeah, I mean, okay, this is true. What you are saying is true. In fact, but for example, we can do this kind of type of exercise with elementary particles. Okay, now with elementary particles, we can produce something which has arbitrary low energy. If I have massless elementary particles, I can produce something which has arbitrary low energy, okay? And but arbitrarily long characteristic wavelengths, okay? For example, I can create a coherent state, okay, of with extremely low low energy photons. It could be arbitrarily big. Right? Yeah, you can. Yeah, you can. You can say, but I mean, this property that what you just mentioned from here will follow automatically, okay? But you want to, what you are saying, if I understood correctly, what you are saying is that you want to substitute, instead use that one. Yeah, okay, but I mean, for me, this is a little bit more well-defined, okay? Right, so, but yeah, but you are right, that property is there, yes. Any other questions? Okay, so then, so what I will try to see, I will try to see if the black holes are have some sort of constituency in this sense, okay? All right, then. Okay, so now let me. So therefore, the question that I'm asking is the following. Suppose I have a black hole of some characteristic, which in classical description has certain characteristic geometric size r, okay, wavelength, the gravitational radius r. So this would be the size, for example, corresponding to this question. And ask this question, okay? Is this an entity, should I treat it as an elementary on this time, on this scale? By the way, one thing I want to mention is the following thing, that whenever I tell you, whenever I ask this question of compositeness, okay, there is no absolute meaning to compositeness. Always there is a question about the length scale. When I say that something is composite, I'm asking at what length scale it is composite, okay? And this a priori is not related necessarily with the mass. For example, let's take this example from QCD, right? In QCD we have pions, okay? Now pions are, these are quark anti-quark bound states, right? I mean, crudely, they are quark anti-quark bound states, but at the same time they are Goldstone bosons. So if quarks were massless, okay, as you know very well, pions would be massless. So pions would be Goldstone bosons. Nevertheless, they would be quark anti-quark bound states in some sense. Okay, now with a massless pion, I can form even a classical object by superimposing many massless pions on top of each other, okay, multi-pion state. I can create a pion wave, which is, in very good approximation, classical. Okay, now, that pion wave will have one type of compositeness because it's simply made out of many pions, okay, whereas pion itself has another type of compositeness at the QCD scale. So you see, there is a hierarchy of scales. Okay, so in other words, I can create a coherent pion wave of the wavelength, certain wavelength L, much larger than the QCD length, okay, QCD inverse. This is approximately 10 to the minus 14 centimeters. Okay, let's say I can produce a pion wave of 1 kilometer wavelength, if there is no problem, okay? I'm working with massless quarks. And of course, this wave will be composite in sense of pions, because it will be composite of pions. But pion itself is composite at the QCD scale of quarks, okay? So there is a hierarchy. So the length scale is important. So therefore, what I'm asking is the following. I have a black hole of size, gravitational size RG, so would be classical size. Let's take black hole in the center of our galaxy, okay? And let's ask this question, I mean, on that scale, is this entity elementary or is composite, okay? In other words, is there a well-defined sense of quantum compositeness of this object? And what's the characteristic length scale of constituents? So this means that I'm assuming that they're constituents, okay? And I'm looking for the characteristic length scale of these constituents. Okay, so this is the question. So now, of course, you can say, yes, black hole is elementary, but it's elementary down at the Planck scale. Okay, so therefore, the characteristic constituency scale has nothing to do with the size of a black hole. This is one possible answer. Okay. However, this answer must be there, either yes or no. So if you say there is a well-defined sense of compositeness at the scale of the black hole size, or it's not there. Okay. So the assumption that I will make, a postulate, will be that there is a well-defined sense of compositeness at this scale. Correspondingly, they are constituents of a black hole with characteristic length scale of order the gravitational radius. Okay. So they are constituents of a black hole with de Broglie wavelengths of the order of the gravitational radius of the corresponding black hole. Okay, so this is the postulate. And let's see where this postulate will take us. Right? Now, of course, immediately once you are asking this question, there is a question of nature of these constituents. I mean, who are they? So now, immediately, there are several questions that we can address. And part of the questions we can address without knowing the precise nature of constituents, okay? Simply the knowledge that constituents exist is enough, okay? Of course, there is a second order question. I mean, who are these constituents? Can we characterize them somehow? And so on and so on, okay? Now, what I will be assuming, the following thing. Now, as you know, we are working in, as we described in the previous lectures, we are working in the framework of effective quantum field theory. Okay, so I'm considering my quantum theory to be gravity. Okay, described by rules of Einstein gravity. So in other words, I will assume that there is graviton, and the interactions among gravitons are given by the rules of Einsteinian gravity, the ones that we described in the previous lecture. Okay. And these rules of the game, they survive down to certain scale, okay? There can be a new scale in which some new gravitational physics can come in. For example, there can be some extra dimensions opening up at some short distances, okay? And it's already possible starting at the fifth of a millimeter, okay? There can be some other type of degrees of freedom, like, let's say, coming from string theory and so on. And this new physics will have some characteristic scale, okay? What I will be assuming is that we are working with black holes which are much larger than this hypothetical new physics scale. Okay, so therefore, the constituents that I will describe cannot come from this new physics. Okay, cannot come from this short distance new physics. Cannot be like Kaluza-Klein gravitons. Cannot be higher registering excitations, and so on. Okay, so therefore, we are working on at the scale which is much larger. So some length scale, much larger than some possible scale of some new ultraviolet completion. Okay, so this is again important to distinguish these two concepts. At that scale, I will use quantum gravity happily because the wavelengths of the gravitons will be much longer than the Planck length, and so on. The usual rules of the game. Of course, I'm not saying that this game is trivial because there are a lot of things there, but okay, the concept is at least manageable. Okay. All right. So now, okay. Then I need a new blackboard probably, but. Anyway, so now, therefore, under these assumptions, it is reasonable to understand, to somehow suspect that constituents of black holes, because there is nothing else, quantum mechanically, should be gravitons. Now, of course, again, as I said, these gravitons are not asymptotic gravitons. Therefore, they will not be on shell. They will be off shell, as usually, whenever we are in the bound state, we are off shell. By the way, I am slightly off shell here because we are in the bound state, okay? But that's precisely the point. We are slightly off shell compared to what we would be in the outer space. Okay, in the so therefore the gravitons. Yeah.
The nature of the constituent shouldn't be like determined by the fact that you have to recover the entropy microscopically.
You are saying naturally they should be that. Of course. That's not just entropy. There is a whole checklist that this idea should pass through, right? Of course. You are absolutely right. So there is a whole checklist. Let me make the checklist here. So first, of course, you have to recover. This picture should allow you to recover in the appropriate limit everything we know in semi-classical limit and classical limit about black holes, okay? This is number one requirement. So you should recover all the limits. So, for example, you should recover in appropriate limits, semi-classically, You should recover Hawking temperature, Stefan Boltzmann law, everything, right? You should understand, of course, entropy. You should understand all possible other properties of black hole. For example, no hair theorems, and etc. This also should be able to understand in this language. Then, you should also understand in this language the how it happens that you can create black holes quantum mechanically in high energy collisions. Okay? So, for example, the black hole creation in high energy. And you should be also be able to understand things that otherwise you cannot understand, like, for example, information scrambling, okay? And this information processing in general, okay? Of course, this is the checklist that you need to go through. This goes without saying. Otherwise, this otherwise theory is not a theory. It's just some general assumption and so on. So I will try to understand how far we can go down this list, okay? All right, so then I was saying something before. So therefore, what is the assumption? The working assumption would be the simplest, okay? So we made it the general assumption, and now we go as simple as possible, right? Let's not complicate the story until we need it to complicate, okay? Therefore, let's assume that whatever we call a black hole, okay, quantum mechanically, should be describable as a state. Okay, a certain occupation number state on a vacuum. I will choose vacuum to be Minkowski. Okay, why do I choose vacuum to be Minkowski? Because typically, in our normal description of gravitons, the Minkowski is the state without any particles. Okay, so it's reasonable to choose the vacuum, which is the state without particles. It's not mandatory. You can choose your vacuum otherwise. Okay. And start from there. But I will choose by vacuum to be Minkowski space. Okay, so vacuum therefore for me will be this. This will be the only geometric input. Okay, no other geometry. All the other geometry should be emergent from this postulate. Okay, that's it. Then this means that everything else should be some state creating by some creation annihilation operators. Okay, some creation operators. Okay, on acting on the vacuum. Okay. All the quantum states have this property. Now, this is the must, because if I don't assume this and I leave the room for something which is not describable in this language, then what I'm saying is not a big deal, right? Then I'm back to the problem. So it only makes sense to ask this question if you believe that this could be a description, okay? Without any other entities which are not describable as quantum states on the vacuum, okay? Now, this is the point. Okay, now let's go to the, then let's see what can be, in this description, a black hole. Now, let me use this part. Okay, so now in this, so what we want to understand is the following thing. Suppose since I'm looking for a black hole as being some kind of a state made out of gravitons, let's do the following thought experiment, okay? So I'll give you a box, okay, of some characteristic size. Let's say, I don't know, let's say 1 kilometer, okay? So I give you a box of size 1 kilometer. And I'll ask that this be the characteristic wavelength of gravitons that we will play with, okay? And now, let's see if there is a regime, okay, in quantum gravitational interaction of these gravitons in which gravitons can form a self-imposed box of this characteristic size, okay? So in other words, if there is a regime in which gravitons can form an approximate bound state of this characteristic size. Okay, so now, therefore, now the gravitons of these wavelengths, the interaction constant of gravitons is ridiculously small, is approximately 10 to the minus 77. So alpha is very small, so this is an extremely weakly coupled theory, okay? So therefore, if I give you 2 gravitons of 1 kilometer wavelength, they don't see each other. There is no way they can form any bound state or anything like that, okay? Now, However, if I keep increasing the number of the gravitons, at some point something may happen. Okay? Now let's try to understand where is the point when something will happen. Okay? So in other words, I have to increase n number of gravitons and then see where do I reach the point when something will happen. So I'm approaching this story from a weak coupling. Now let me make the following parameterization, which is very important, because whenever we have n-body systems, okay, it is useful to define two types of couplings. Okay, so one is the coupling simply alpha, but there is another coupling, as we will see, it will emerge automatically, n times alpha. Okay, so somehow n times alpha is a collective coupling, which tells you how important the collective effects could be. Okay, this is widely used, for example, in condensed metaphysics and stuff. This type of coupling happens all the time, even in gauge theories. This is called Toft coupling. Okay, in large color QCD and so on. Now this will emerge, as we will see. Okay, from here. So therefore, let me do the following thing. I want to understand where is the critical n for which something will happen, and these gravitons or wavelengths L can form a bound state. Okay. What should I do? I should scatter them. Okay. What I do scattering of gravitons. So I have an n graviton system. And what is the situation? The situation is that in the first approximation, because I'm in the weak coupling regime, in tremendously weak coupling regime, I will look for the effect on individual gravitons coming from the rest. Okay, so I have one graviton and there is n minus one, and this n minus one is acting on this one. Okay, so in other words, I'm looking from the point of each graviton the scattering between one and n minus one. Okay, and see when the scattering becomes important so that it can potentially form a bound state. So what do I have to do? I have to do the following thing, right? I have to okay, I have to do this type of scattering amplitude, okay, between 1 and n minus 1 or n, because since we are in large n, okay, this difference doesn't matter for a moment, okay, so between n and n. Okay, so I have to compute this scattering amplitude. Okay, now, as we discussed in the previous lecture, okay, we can compute, and now we will see where quantum mechanics enters, where is the classical part. The classical part that will survive as a limit when I take classical limit of the theory, and what is new coming from quantum mechanics. Okay, where is quantum mechanics here? Now, what is this amplitude? This S-matrix element for this thing will be the following expression, right? So will be, okay, there is an interaction between these gravitons, right? So will be, okay, dx, let's say dx1, dx2 integral, okay? Two vertex interaction. T mu nu at some point x, 1, then the graviton propagator, and T alpha beta at point, sorry, x1, x2, x2, okay? Where? Where the, okay, let me lift this up. Where the where this is the graviton, this is the graviton propagator that we derived in the previous lecture. Let me just remind you that this is simply one over box acting on the following tensorial structure. It will be symmetrized, mu alpha, nu beta, symmetrized. I have chosen the same gauge, the Donder gauge, okay, for this. So this is the graviton propagator, which, okay, this is one over box, all right? Or you can, I don't know, let me write it here. Or, of course, you can rewrite it in the Fourier transform form. It would be phi square with the same tensorial structure, okay? Now, okay, the G Newton, I can write either here or there. Okay, I can write it there. So there must be G Newton, sorry. Because each vertex is square root from G Newton, so therefore will be one G Newton here, okay? Okay, so now, so where is quantum mechanics there, right? So we showed that the, right, in this diagram, where is quantum mechanics? Where is quantum mechanics in this expression? Now, quantum mechanics is not in this virtual graviton exchange. This virtual graviton exchange would perfectly nicely give you what would be the classical force, okay, between any source with the energy momentum T mu nu and T mu nu, okay? This will simply give you that. So the quantum mechanics here is in T mu nu, okay? The fact that now T mu nu, okay, this is, all these T mu nu are normal ordered products of the creation and annihilation operators, okay? So this is very important because this is bilinear in H, okay? So therefore, T mu nu, quantum mechanically, okay, what is important? Important is that each T mu nu will give you, factors of, so T mu nu is bilinear in H square, okay? Right? So this gives you factor of H. Right, because remember, since this is classically, this is bilinear in H, this is bilinear in H, and classically, H is square root from H bar times quantum, which in something quantum that involves creation and annihilation operators, okay? Now, this H bar, H hats, these are just normal creation and annihilation operators with some tensorial structure, okay, with some helicities, you have to separate helicities accurately and so on. But this is not important for this quantumness discussion. Quantumness discussion is important is this. And the fact that these guys are normal order products of some creation and annihilation operators, which means that they have the structure of the form A dagger A. Of course, you will have this summation over momenta, and helicity tensors, and so on, okay? This is the entourage that always is there. So that's where the quantum mechanics enters. So this means that quantum mechanics enters in these two H bars that appear in these two vertices, okay? Now, where else the quantum mechanics enters? The quantum mechanics enters in the quantum state in which you have to take, in and out quantum state in which you have to take this matrix element. Okay? This n here, right? So your in state is some n graviton state plus one graviton, and then out state is some n graviton state plus one graviton. There is some transition. Of course, this transition is scattering, so the initial and final momenta will not be equal, and so on, okay? The usual scattering. Okay, so now let's see what this diagram will give us. Actually, it's very easy because of the following reason, right? What do we have? We will have one H bar from here, okay, in T mu nu, right? Now, remember that we are simplifying our life because we are considering n graviton story with characteristic wavelengths L, okay? So all the momenta are of the order H over L. Okay? So, therefore, once I convolute, I'm looking for the initial states of this type. Once I convolute the matrix elements and integrate over, the characteristic momentum that will appear is this. Okay? So, what do we get? We get the following structure, right? So, now, watch that thing. So, the propagator. Okay, so T mu nu will give me the following factor, right? Each T mu nu will give me H bar. Then creation annihilation operators order, I have the normal order, right? There will be two creation, two destruction and two creation operators, okay? Some structure like this. And I have to convolute between initial and final states, okay? So I destroy one graviton, create one graviton, destroy one graviton, create one graviton, except there is this N, okay? This is an N graviton state. And so what will happen is that let's separate what will happen is that the graviton, which is responsible for the vertex here, right? This will give me some kind of matrix element of this form, A dagger A, N. And this will give me a factor of N. Because simply I'm looking, because initial state is N graviton state. And okay, that's where the quantum information enters. Okay? The information is here about N. Okay? Let's put all the factors together. It's very easy, right? So now the each of these guys gives me H bar. So therefore will be H bar times N. H bar over L times N, okay? Then the graviton propagator will give me G Newton over L. And then the other graviton, but it's only one, will not give me the factor of N, okay? One pair from here will not give me factor of N, and will give me H bar over L, okay? This is the result of this matrix, this is the matrix element. The matrix element will be of this order. But notice what is this? This is H bar over L. This is Planck length square divided by L square. So this is alpha gravity times N. Now, when something will happen? Something will happen when the matrix element of quantum mechanical scattering will become of the order 1, no scattering. Right? In other words, will become, so in other words, the potential energy, so what is this? In the Bohr approximation, this is a potential energy of one graviton in the gravitational, but quantum mechanical gravitational field created, quantum mechanical interaction, okay? Due to quantum gravity interaction between this one graviton and partners and other gravitons, okay? Now, the bound state will appear when this will become comparable to the energy of this free graviton. Okay? So bound state will appear when becomes comparable to H over L. Which means that alpha N has to be 1. Now, this you can even... Now, this is something that you could have guessed also thinking in terms of Newtonian force between gravitons, okay? This is simply that, because this is what we just recovered. This is just simply Newtonian force at distance one over, at distance L between graviton pairs, H with energy H over L, and then N times. This is simply, the physical meaning of this is that what we got? We got the fact that when the Newtonian interaction between the N gravitons and one member, okay, Newtonian binding energy, I mean calling it Newtonian, but it's not Newtonian really, because this is, of course, gravitons are relativistic, but let's call it Newtonian in that sense, okay? Becomes comparable to the kinetic energy of a graviton, okay? Then the bound state is formed. So this is the first glimpse of the bound state that you are capturing from this scattering analysis. Now, let's see what are the properties of this bound state, okay? Now, the properties of the bound state are the mass goes as N times H bar over L, okay? But notice from here that this bound state means that alpha gravity is 1 over N. But what is alpha gravity? Alpha gravity is the same as L Planck square over L square, right? From here, L is square root of N L Planck. So therefore, mass goes like square root of N M Planck. So the size of this bound state, let me call it R, goes as square root of N L Planck. Mass goes like square root of N M Planck. Now, these are parameters of a black hole, okay? Because this is precisely the relation between the mass and the Schwarzschild radius of a black hole, okay? So, therefore, what this expression is telling you, that this bound state, to the first approximation, looks like a black hole, with its parameters, okay? Now, what's the classical limit that I can take? Okay, what would be the classical limit? First of all, what would be the classical limit and what would be the semi-classical limit, okay, of this structure? The classical limit would be when I take, okay, in both cases, I have to take L Planck going to zero and keep R fixed, right? This means that I have to take L Planck to zero, but because R is L, okay, the wavelengths of the gravitons, right, because this is R, happen to be the same thing as wavelengths of the gravitons, right? I have to keep fixed square root of n times L Planck fixed, which means that n has to go to infinity. So, the classical limit or semi-classical limit of this configuration, which gives you some black hole type object, classical or semi-classical black hole type object, is the limit of infinite occupation number of constituents. Now, then, depending whether you want to keep h bar fixed or not, now in this limit I didn't specify whether I was taking h bar to zero or not. If I'm not taking h bar to zero, then this will be a semi-classical black hole, okay? And then I'm forced to take mass to infinity. Because since n goes to infinity and h bar is fixed, m has to go to infinity. Okay? But if I want to be classical, then I can take h bar to zero happily, and then I can have finite m. Of course, in any case, both classical and semi-classical, because L Planck goes to zero, n has to go to infinity. So in both cases, semi-classical or classical, n goes to infinity. Okay? Now, let's see what we can learn from this construction, okay? Now, one immediate thing that you learn from this construction is the following thing, that these constituents, as you see, I'm trying to be maximally general, right? I'm trying to not to impose some extra assumptions, right? So, their constituents, their wavelength is given by the characteristic size, turns out to become a characteristic size of this object. Now, one thing we immediately learn is the following, that there is no way to keep this bound state stable if you have both h bar and m finite, and g Newton, of course. Okay? There is no way. Why? Because inevitably there will be processes of the following sort, that I have now this n graviton state, and there will be rescattering between the gravitons, which will take n to n minus 1, and 1 becomes member of the continuum. In other words, there is a finite probability for rescattering, which will give any of the constituents the missing part of the momentum to become part of the continuum. Okay? The threshold to go to continuum is very small. It's 1 over the size of the system. Okay? So let's estimate the rate of this process. What is the rate of this process? So it's very simple, because I have n graviton state, they interact with alpha, and I have to estimate once in a while they want to rescatter, and one of them gets enough kinetic energy to pull away, okay, to escape to continue. Okay, what's the rate of this process? The rate of the process goes as alpha squared, okay, times number of pairs. The number of pairs scales as n square. Okay, n minus 1, but okay, this to the leading order in n, it scales like n square. And times the inverse characteristic wavelengths. This is the rescattering rate, which means that at this rate, this bound state is bound to lose its constituents. Okay? So, once every delta t of order of inverse gamma, which is, because alpha n is order 1, this simply becomes r. Once every its size, this bound state loses a constituent. So it's a bound state which sometimes we call leaky, okay? So it is a bound state, but it leaks the constituents. However, it is an incredibly long-lived bound state, right? So now, what are we learning from this expression? We are learning from this expression. The moment you assume this type of constituents, you are automatically getting some quantum radiation from this system with a characteristic wavelength r and characteristic emission time r. So in other words, evolution, now we can write down the equation for the evolution of n. Okay, so this is simply dn dt. This is the evolution equation for n. Now let's do a consistency check, okay? Let's go in this limit. Well, let's take n infinity, fix the size, okay, and see what this gives me. And translate n in terms of the mass. Then this simply, in this limit, semi-classical limit, in this, let me call it semi-classical. This gives you Stefan Boltzmann law for the Hawking Stefan Boltzmann law. Sorry, yeah, there is a minus there, yeah. Okay. Now, okay, what we are learning is that there is some general property. Now, irrespectively whether this is what underlines Hawking radiation from a black hole or whatever, there is some interesting underlying property of n-graviton bound states when n is of order alpha, 1 over alpha, okay? In other words, when alpha n is order 1, this system has this property of leakage. It's a bound state, but it's not a stable bound state. It loses every characteristic time scale compared to the wavelength, its constituent. Now, number of times, what is the lifetime of this? We can integrate this easily, and the lifetime goes as n in power 3 halves L Planck, which translated in the language of the RGs and stuff is, not surprisingly, since this is the same Stefan Boltzmann law, not surprisingly, this gives you the would-be lifetime of a black hole. Okay. Now, what is important here? Important here is not that we reproduced some Stefan Boltzmann law in a specific limit. Important here is the lesson, what are we learning about the corrections to this Stefan Boltzmann law? And what we are learning about these corrections is the following thing, that corrections are inevitably 1 over n corrections to all the processes. So in other words, the corrections per emission time, corrections that corrects this picture, which in the semi-classical limit would give you nice thermal spectrum, etc., goes as 1 over n. Now, this is the quantum information, okay? This n is something that semi-classically you cannot guess because semi-classically it doesn't have a meaning. Semi-classically, n is infinite, okay? So, finite n means that we are in quantum mechanics, and these 1 over n corrections are the key to understanding how black hole processes the information, okay? So, in other words, this law this has corrections which go like higher power, so 1 over n. And these are the important corrections. Now, let's try to understand why they are important, okay? By the way, why I'm presenting this as something very important, the reason is the following. Because what you would naively expect for a semi-classical, normal semi-classical object, okay, is that corrections go like exponent minus n, okay? Now, normal semi-classical physics is what intuition that we have for normal objects, like for example, I don't know, this table or a laser pulse, whatever. Corrections would go as exponent minus some effective classical action, okay? Now, n recovers the classical action in h bar units precisely, okay? And so that's what you would expect. But here, what is the surprise? Precisely, the corrections go like 1 over n and not exponent minus n, Okay, this is the key. Now, why is this important? Because black hole leaves extremely, let's call this object a black hole. Of course, we didn't prove that it's a black hole. We just see slowly that this is something that looks like a black hole. Okay, this object leaves extremely long, okay, because it leaves like n in power 3/2, or it leaves exactly n emission time, okay? So it's n times emission time. This is the lifetime. In other words, if you correct the thermality by 1 over n per emission time, this means that during half lifetime, your corrections accumulate to 100%. Okay? These are the corrections in which the information processing is hidden for the system. Okay? Now, the way you can think about it, unfortunately, how much time do I have, by the way? I'm over time now? No.
No, you still have 15
minutes. 15 minutes, okay, all right. So 15 minutes, but let's try to understand what is expected to happen, okay? Okay, I could have done it from there. Anyway, so now the way you can think about this is the following thing, right? Think about a black hole or this object, okay, as an n long message of zeros and ones, okay? Now, I didn't have time to tell you what are the degrees of freedom in which the zeros and ones are encoded, okay? But okay, for a moment, just let's say that I put a message, n long message, composed out of zeros and ones. Now, this is concrete knowledge of the microscopic quantum physics, you can always think about the black hole, knowing that it has entropy n, you can always think about it as a message which is n long and is a sequence of zeros and ones, okay? So you have n positions and they can take 0 and 1 value, okay? This is the typical message you can encode in a system with entropy n, okay? You don't have to know what is the underlying physics there, right? Now, with every emission, black hole is becoming lighter. So what happens is that this message with every emission is becoming by one position shorter, okay? So with every emission, n goes into n minus 1, okay? Now, the emitted quantum is somehow related with this, whatever was encoding the message, okay? The emitted quantum, however, is almost like thermal, with a departure, tiny departure, 1 over n, okay? So now, imagine that you have an observer, okay? So here is this object, and we have an observer, Alice. And now Alice is trying to decode this message, okay? Now you get a quantum which has tiny deviation from thermality. Deviation is extremely small; it's 1/n. For example, for a solar mass black hole, this deviation would be 10^-77. Okay, 10^-77 is a very small deviation. Of course, smaller is the deviation, there is certain accuracy of your measurement. Of course, it takes time for you to decode this difference. Okay, so you decode this difference, but decoding this difference is not enough to restore this information because you only got one part of the message out of n, okay? Still, there is an exponentially large part of the message that is unavailable for you. So, by decoding one quantum, even if you can tell the difference between the thermal spectrum and this the radiation spectrum, you can only decode exponentially small part of information, okay? Essentially nothing. Now, let's ask this question. How long you have to wait in order to start decoding the information at an order one rate? Start, not decode, but start to decode, okay? You have to wait until the message becomes approximately half short, okay? So after the message becomes approximately half short, with deviations 1/n, now you have full access to start decoding information. Now, this very simple reasoning coincides with so-called Page's time. Now, Page showed that this should be property of a black hole, okay, based on very general argument, okay, without any microstructure, just based on very general quantum mechanical argument. This argument exactly gives you this Page's time. Now, what is happening at Page's time? So, okay, here there are several processes which are taking place. And all of these processes are extremely interesting, okay? They are extremely interesting from the point of view of information processing, and so on and so on. What are the processes? The processes are that every emission generates some entanglement, okay? In other words, the initial state of these zeros and ones could be totally unentangled state, okay? Simply could be a tensor product, all right? So think in the following way, okay? Think about the zeros and ones, each of them living in some imaginary spin space, okay? Plus or minus, spin up, spin down, okay? Right? You have n of those guys. So zero or one, zero is spin up, one is spin down, or other way around, okay? Now, the initial state that you can have could be the zeros and ones, and in terms of those guys, could be simply tensor product, okay? Totally unentangled. Right? Unentangled, I mean the following, that you have, let's say, let's take two, right? You can have plus or minus, or up, down, okay, and that's it, right? Instead, you could have entangled state in which you would have some combination of plus, down, plus, minus, down, up, right? And so on, okay? So you don't have this, you have fully unentangled state. But what happens is that with every step of emission, you generate some entanglement. You generate entanglement among the remaining ones, and you also generate entanglement among the ones that are emitted and remained, okay? So now, this generation of the entanglement is directly related with how the black hole processes the information that you can add to it, okay? Let's say at some t equals zero, I add some one bit of information to a black hole, and how this information gets processed, okay? This has to do with so-called scrambling phenomena, okay, of black hole information. Now, okay, I only have 5 minutes, so to discuss scrambling in these 5 minutes is impossible, but there is the following story in black hole physics. This is one of the things on the checklist. It has been conjectured in semi-classical description that black holes should be the fastest scramblers of information. Okay, this was by Preskill and Hayden and also Susskind and others. So, but in semi-classical framework, you cannot. Now, what is scrambling, first of all, okay, of the information? Scrambling of the information is, okay, let me define in the following way, okay? Semi-classically, I don't know any good way of defining it. I don't know, maybe Nico knows. For example, I really don't know. Very good, okay, you see? You see? Yeah, right, no, that I understand, but, okay. Anyway, so the but you can very very crudely you can define it the following way, okay? So I don't know, with analogy, you have the room of people, and somebody enters and tells you the message, and then how long does it take to store this message in all our brains, okay? In other words, how fast the system can redistribute the message among its members and constituents, okay? Now, of course, this is why this is intrinsically quantum notion, because this deals with the constituents of the system, with the quantum constituents of the system. Semi-classically, if you think about system as being uniform, scrambling time is infinite, okay? So it's exactly by the same reason why these other infinities appear in black hole physics in semi-classical limit. So therefore, but this conjecture has been made, and to verify this conjecture, you need a quantum framework, okay? Otherwise, you cannot verify it. Now, this, again, I don't have time to discuss this, but this is one of the things that this framework can at least give you some idea how the scrambling works in these systems, okay, because they're constituents. Now, before finishing, finally, let me discuss one last point. Now, I said that corrections go as 1 over n versus exponent minus n, okay? And I said that this is very strange, because normal semi-classical objects, the corrections, quantum corrections to semi-classical systems are exponentially small, okay? Now, it seems that black holes are very special, because corrections go like 1 over n as opposed to exponent minus n. Now, what makes the corrections to go like 1 over n? And the answer to this question is the following, that black holes are not really semi-classical. They are intrinsically quantum. Okay. Now, this sounds a little bit dramatic, this statement, because you can say, oh, I have a black hole in the center of the galaxy, which is huge, and normally we associate the classicality to big things, okay? But that's not true, because there are systems which are, even in condensed matter, there are systems which are, they can be macroscopic, but quantum mechanics could be 100% important. Now, one class of these systems are typically the systems which are so-called at the point of quantum phase transition, okay? Now, it turns out that this system, if I describe it in that language, in condensed matter language, let's say, this system is precisely at the quantum phase transition point. In other words, quantum phase transition happens at alpha n equals 1 for this system. Now, the way you can understand this is the following, right? Okay, the way you can understand this is that what have we observed, right? We said, okay, we have n graviton system, and when is the quantum mechanical interaction between this n graviton system strong enough to create a bound state, okay? Now, we have two phases, right? Because there was a phase of free gravitons when they could not care about each other, could not care less about each other. For example, I could have taken a box, put in this box these n gravitons, and if alpha n is much less than 1, this would be the picture. Let me put it here. Let me take a box, and in this box, let's plot alpha n, okay? Let me take a box of the fixed size, then I put some n gravitons in this box, and I can manipulate by changing the size of the box, I can rearrange the wavelengths of the gravitons. Since I can rearrange wavelengths of the gravitons, I can change alpha. Okay, so I can make, let's say I fix n, and I can change alpha arbitrarily. Then I can put my box here. In other words, alpha n could be much less than 1. So this is 1, okay? Alpha n could be much, much less than 1. For example, if I take a box of 1 kilometer, all right, and I put 10 to the 66 gravitons in 1 kilometer box, okay? Let's say if n is 10 to the 66, and the size of the box is 1 kilometer, This would be a typical story. So alpha would be very small. And the gravitons would not see each other effectively. Okay? So effectively, the system will prefer to be in the uniform state. Now, by making box smaller and smaller, I'm decreasing the wavelengths of the gravitons. So I'm making them stronger interacting. So I'm increasing alpha. So let's say n is the same, but I can increase the alpha. So when I reach for L approximately 1 centimeter, what will happen is that alpha n will become 1. So I will reach this point. Now from here, as we described, the quantum mechanical effects are 100% important. So in other words, there is a transitional point when the uniform state rearranges itself and wants to go to the bound state. So we are right there. Now, whenever you are right there, and the transition is quantum, because interactions are quantum. This is purely quantum phase transition. It happens at zero temperatures. Now, because we are there, that's why quantum mechanics is 100% important. So this is an exceptionally singular situation. You don't find this situation in normal macroscopic bodies. This table is not at the quantum critical point, for example. But black holes are. So black holes are extremely special because they are something that is stuck at the quantum critical point of this phase transition. That's why normal semi-classical intuition is not applicable. And that's why these corrections are very large. 1 over n correction, is, as I tried to demonstrate, this is gigantic for black hole physics. Okay. So then probably I should stop here because we are over time. And then we are not yet over time, but we'll be in 1 microsecond. And, okay, I'll take questions if there are any.
Yeah. Could one describe what would happen when two black holes meet using a quantum description? So if describing a quantum description of a black hole, then could you describe the interaction of two black holes?
Sure. Of course, you need a pretty powerful, you need very, very smart graduate students or something like that, but yeah, there's no problem. But I have to erase something. From this point of view, the interaction between two black holes, let's say one has occupation number n, and characteristic size, correspondingly characteristic size is fixed, right? So the size will be square root of n in Planck units. And the other one, let's say, has n prime, and correspondingly characteristic size is like n prime, L Planck. Now, in this language, these are simply n graviton and n prime graviton states, okay? You can compute all possible processes. Like, well, there will be processes like when they simply exchange graviton. So now, what's very important is the following. There will be part of the processes which survive in semi-classical limit, okay? Those will be processes which will recover normal metric motion, okay? For example, the two motion of two black holes, as you can describe binaries, whatever you normally you describe in normal classical physics. Now, what are those processes? Those are the processes in the quantum mechanical language in which the n-graviton and n-prime graviton systems, they recoil as a whole. In other words, you don't have processes with the momentum transfer to individual constituents. It's like a Mesbauer effect, okay, in some sense. Those are the processes which recover, which survive in the classical limit. The processes which correspond to these 1 over n corrections, those are the processes when individual gravitons you can resolve. In other words, there will be some momentum transfer between them or graviton creation and so on, and those will be intrinsically quantum mechanical, okay? So this will be, for example, interaction between two black holes. In this language, you can also describe merger of the two black holes. For example, there will be processes which will give you some. Of course, you have to resum many diagrams, but finally, this would give you some effective black hole with some n double prime. Will not be simply a direct sum of the two n because the wavelength should rearrange. But this is what will happen. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I could not get to the entropy because in general. So what's the philosophy according to entropy here? Now, this let me put it down. No, sorry. Now, in this plot, so there is one technique which is. I think it's probably one of the most useful for this problem. This notion is known in condensed metaphysics. All of you know this Bogoliubov way. In other words, the description in terms of Bogoliubov modes of many large n systems. Okay. Now, what is the idea? The idea is that when I have large n systems which have and in particular, the ones that can have some approximately classical limit. What is classical limit? Classical limit is that when, for example, for Bose condensate, Einstein condensate, when you go to the effective mean field description, when it is good, because when occupation numbers, the creation and annihilation operators, they become approximately C numbers, right? So creation operator approximately becomes, you can replace by the square root from the occupation number, right? Becomes like a C number, okay? When the number, why? Because when occupation number is huge, difference between n and n plus 1 is very small. That's the idea, right? That's the whole point. What is classicality in that respect, right? If I have one quantum only, then of course difference between 0 and 1 is enormous. But the difference between 10 to the 66 and 10 to the 66 plus 1 should be negligible. That's why in the classical limit, in large n limit, you can replace the occupation, creation and annihilation operators, you can replace by C numbers, okay? Now, this technique of Bogoliubov modes tells you the following, that instead of describing your system in terms of original particles, okay, it is useful to describe the system in terms of collective modes, okay? So, what does it mean? It means that you are rediagonalizing your Hamiltonian, and you are describing your system in terms of modes that do not correspond to your individual input particles anymore, but they are collective, okay? So, these are so-called Bogoliubov modes, okay? Now, the point is that in the processes in which there is a quantum phase transition, And this is a known story in let's say, cold atomic systems. What happens is that, okay, typically what you would have this kind of, so this would be a ground state, let's say, would be ground uniform phase. Let's put some bosons in the box, okay, uniform, gravitons in this particular case. And then I start changing the size of the box. Now, initially, when I'm here, let's say, at very, very small alpha n, much less than 1, this is a system of almost free particles, and you will have some energy levels, collective energy levels, and these energy levels will be typically spaced like the inverse size of the system, okay? So in other words, this gap here would be something like h bar over L, okay? Where L is the characteristic size of your system. This is a very normal quantum mechanical intuition, okay? Right? So for example, if I take this table or gravitational field of the Earth, and I compute what are the effective Bogoliubov levels for the gravitational field of the Earth, they will be scaled with approximately inverse size of the Earth. Now, inverse size of the Earth, of course, is a tiny energy scale. But you can do this exercise. Compute how long it would take to excite a single Bogoliubov mode in the gravitational field of the Earth. And it takes like 20 orders of magnitude larger than the age of the universe, okay? Because of the weakness of the gravitational interaction. So, because for exciting a level, it's not only important that level is small, but it's also how strong is the interaction, because if theory is free, nothing will be excited, right? That's the point. So, now, however, it turns out that what happens at the quantum critical point is that the Bogoliubov levels, they come and become gapless, okay? This is a known phenomenon called atomic physics, for example. Now, this is really incredible, because you see what happens. What happens is that here, at the quantum critical point, normal intuition breaks down, because normally you would say, oh, if I have a box to put one bit of information in this box, I need to put a particle, so I have to invest energy h bar over L. No, here you don't have to invest that energy. Here the energy that you have to invest is 1 over n times that, okay? So this is really incredible, because this is telling you that somehow at quantum critical point, because system is so unstable and unsure, it allows you to store more information essentially for free, okay? So now this is a known phenomenon of nature. On its own, it's extremely interesting, by the way, even regardless of any black holes or anything like that, okay? So now in this framework, philosophy is that these are precisely the ones that store entropy, okay? In other words, the idea is that, of course, there is a long way to go to really see this in the case of gravitons with all spins and stuff. But the idea is that this phenomena, the fact that we see that this is a quantum critical point, and we know that there is this general tendency at quantum critical point that levels come down, this is the point where the entropy appears. Okay. So in other words, instead of having one quantum state here, you have exponent n quantum states, okay? So there is an enhancement, like exponential enhancement on number of microstates. And that's the entropy. Now, at the same time, of course, there is no free lunch, because this may look like it's a free lunch, right? Because I just told you, oh, it's very nice. You just bring a system in which you have quantum criticality, okay? And there is a free lunch. You can store information for free. No, because Bogoliubov modes also get decoupled as 1 over n. So the information, of course, you can store it at less energy expense, but it's much more time costly to recover it, okay? Because it's an extremely weakly coupled mode. So therefore, you store information, but at the same time, you increase the time scale of recovery. And this, of course, matches the whole story of the black hole physics. That's precisely what is happening. That's why if black hole is eternal, you never recover information, okay? So this is the understanding in this picture. Where the entropy is coming from, okay? All right. Yeah.
One assumes that the black hole has a massive object at the center.
Sorry?
If one assumes that the black hole has at its center some massive material object.
You mean the classical black hole, or?
Yeah, for example. Yeah.
Classical black hole. Classical black hole. You are talking about Schwarzschild black hole.
Yes.
Yeah, classical black hole is an eternal black hole, which is there for forever, right? And in this language, it corresponds to n going to infinity limit, as I just described, right? So the classical limit is n going to infinity. So, yeah.
And there's a neutron star, which corresponds to
Ah, so your question is, okay, your question is different. Yeah. No, but this is a different question. Let's separate the two questions, because one thing is to assume that there is a massive body in the center of a black hole and stuff like this. This is you are talking about singularity, classical singularity. This is not you are asking. You are asking what happens to other particles when you form a black hole in this picture. What happens to other particles? That's the question, right? No, this is a very good question. So question is like, let's say I don't want to form black hole only by gravitons. I form it. Of course, nice thing about gravity is that gravity does not require anyone. Gravity can form a black hole on its own, no problem. But no, theoretically, I'm saying gravitational theory has black holes on its own. Doesn't need an external source. Now, normal astrophysical black holes, they are formed as a result of a collapse of baryonic matter, or maybe dark matter, I don't know. Okay, so now your question is, what happens to those baryons when they're dry? What happens to those baryons is the following thing. Of course, if you collapse and make black holes out of other particles, depending whether those particles are stable, unstable, long-lived, short-lived, let's assume they are stable, then you will get a mixture. You will, of course, get some non-zero occupation number of baryons inside the black hole, okay? Now, the thing is, however, and this is very important, that this is a universal property of a black hole, that occupation number is always dominated by occupation number of gravitons. Why? Because everybody else also gravitates. In other words, you cannot add a baryon to a black hole without also adding a graviton. And if baryon is massive, you are adding much more gravitons than the baryon. For example, if I do this computation, take a neutron star and ask the following question. If I collapse a neutron star into a black hole, how many baryons I will have and how many gravitons? According to this picture. So the difference would be approximately 22 orders of magnitude. So the NB over N will be approximately 10 to the minus 21 or something like that, if I remember correctly. Anyway, humongous. I don't know, maybe Glennis remembers. Yeah, right. So what happens is that the baryons, they are way subdominant in number.
Not
in the mass, right. But in number, they are way sub. No. In mass, gravitons contribute the full scale because gravitons contribute into gravitational energy because they are a lot. So once after you form a black hole formation is precisely the point where gravitational self-energy coming from gravitons becomes 100% important, okay? Of course, you can continue to have other energy sources. That's perfectly fine. But the number always will be subdominant, okay? So then, of course, it's an interesting question to study what would be the effect of these baryons in the black hole, whether you can have some observable consequences, observational consequences, and this kind of stuff. No, these are interesting questions. Yeah, absolutely. For example, this is one of the hopes how to test these ideas. Because in the normal picture, you don't have any baryonic charge in a black hole. The baryonic charge is lost. In this picture, you continue to have baryonic charge, and the infalling particles can interact with baryons, and you can have some effects. So it's an interesting question. Yeah, it's an open question, right? Right. Yeah.
When you have a black hole with an inner and outer gravitons, what would be the scale of the
distance? You mean, for example, if you have a charged black hole? Yeah, if you have a charged black hole, the story a little bit, you have to modify accordingly, although you can describe also in this language, because what happens in a charged black hole is that you also get occupation number of photons because of the electric fields, okay?
But the size would be the inner or outer?
No, that would be both are the legitimate sizes. Both this size is now we have two, because you have two parameters now in the theory, so it's not surprising. I mean, you have two length scales because you have you have charge and the mass, and you will have two length scales. And there will be some characteristic length scale associated with gravitons, some characteristic length scale associated with photons, and this can be fully legitimate length scales. Of course, because you are affecting the system by introducing a charge. That's a different story. By the way, I mean, there is not much, I'm not aware of much investigation in that direction. I mean, how to understand charged black holes. But the principle is the same. You just introduce extra particles, extra constituents coming from the electric field, okay? Because electric field on its own, you can think of it as being composite in this picture. So then you have two constituents and there will be corresponding length scales. For example, the same is true, by the way, for the black holes with magnetic charges. For example, you know that in semi-classical In a semi-classical picture, there are solutions of black holes with magnetic charges, for example. Okay? So black hole which carries a magnetic charge. And in that picture, you can see that magnetic charge cannot exceed the mass of a black hole. Okay? So you can write down a solution, but it will be singular. Now, in that language, you don't understand why, right? Because naively you say, what's wrong? Why can't I have? But this language tells you actually immediately, because the point where magnetic charges and the mass becomes equal is the point when the number of gauge constituents and gravitational constituents becomes equal. And after that, you can no longer have a black hole. You can have, for example, a magnetic monopole with a black hole in the center. That's not a problem. You can have very fat magnetic monopole, Tolstoy-Polyakov, with a black hole at the center. That's perfectly fine. But then you have something outside of a black hole. Right. Yeah?
Also, just using this language, can one get into sort of geometric and interpretation of the substructure of the black hole?
Right. So, yeah, the question, this is important because the, let me describe it here. In other words, the question is where is the geometry emerging, right? Partially we answered this. Now, geometry emerges, let's say I want to consider some reconstruct geometry from the quantum mechanics, right? Geometry is emerging. Now, how do I reconstruct it? Of course, in quantum mechanics, I have only scattering. My quantum entity is a scattering S matrix. So I have to compute scattering between the external probe, let's say. This probe on its own could be quantum or classical. And the source, the black hole. Now I told you that there will be process. Now you can do these two orders in G Newton. Okay. Now there are several limits that you have to watch. Okay. So as I said, there will be part of the processes here which survive in n going to infinity limits. Okay. These processes, what will happen is that the scattering amplitude. Okay. Of this part, in this limit, effectively will reproduce the motion of, let's say this is a probe, motion of this probe in some external metric, let's call it GV nu, okay? Which if this probe depends where it is and what situation, will reproduce the corresponding classical metric. Now the question is, what would be the corrections? The corrections are, as I also mentioned there, they will come from the processes in which you have momentum exchange with individual gravitons, okay? Now, these type of processes don't survive when n goes to infinity, so they are like 1/n corrections. But it is extremely important that these 1/n corrections, you cannot recast, it's impossible to recast as a motion in a corrected metric, you see? I cannot say that now I have some metric prime, and this metric prime is classical plus some correction, quantum correction. No, this will not exist. That's the point. Simply, these are corrections which will never be understandable in the metric language. Okay? So this is basically a very general thing because, as we know, right, it's impossible to understand quantum mechanics as modified classical mechanics. This is exactly the same reason. You cannot understand intrinsically quantum correction in the language of corrected metric. Only the semi-classical ones. So that's why, for example, as you know, there are quantum corrections coming from the loops. Quantum corrections coming from the loops you can understand in this way, okay? Because you can integrate loops out and you can write down an effective semi-classically corrected metric, okay? That's also H-bar expansion, but it's a different expansion. So these corrections are 1/n corrections which are not reducible to that. And this is extremely important, okay?